This week on CW11 Remembers, some 40 years ago, Mickey Mouse almost came to St. Louis.
In his own inimitable fashion, basically said that any man that would build a theme park in St. Louis and not sell beer was a fool. Well, Walt was really offended, and he left the meeting.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future.
Born December 5, 1901, in Chicago, Illinois, Walter Elias Disney would go on to become one of the leading voices of 20th century entertainment. At age 4, Walt's family moved to Marceline, Missouri, now home of the Walt Disney Boyhood Home Museum, and then again at age 9, Walt and his family moved, this time to Kansas City, Missouri. For 6 years, Walt's father owned a newspaper route on which Walt and his brothers worked. This is until Walt eventually dropped out of high school as something more dangerous lurked on the horizon. A war to end all wars. As World War I loomed, Walt Disney's family sold their paper route and moved back to Chicago. But Walt, the recent high school dropout, decided to forge a birth certificate so that way he could appear 18 and enlist in the Red Cross Ambulance Corps. Eventually, in 1919, after being dishonorably discharged, Walt Disney went back to Kansas City. It was here that Walt opened Laugh-O-Gram Studios, his first foray into the world of animation. Walt Disney's childhood fascination with art would soon lead to a full-fledged career. In the early 1920s in Kansas City, Missouri, Walt formed Laugh-O-Gram Studios. Although this venture did not prove ultimately very successful, only 10 shorts were produced, many of which were based off of pre-existing fairy tales or nursery rhymes, like Goldilocks and the Three Bears or Jack and the Beanstalk. Only one of these shorts would be very successful, and that was Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, a live-action and animation hybrid short which led to the Alice comedies, Walt's first taste of real success, and obviously eventually served as inspiration for the Walt Disney animated classic, Alice in Wonderland. Not wanting to give up on his dream, Walt Disney closed the failing studio and moved to LA to start over, forming a new studio with partner Ub Iwerks and his brother, Roy Disney. Here is where he created characters such as Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, Mickey Mouse, Dopey and the other dwarves, and many other characters that we all know and love today. Although in LA is where Walt ultimately found his success, he never forgot his roots back in Missouri.
Your attention, please. The Disneyland Limited, now arriving from a trip around Walt Disney's Magic Kingdom. Passengers will stand by to board.
After years of success in the world of animation with the likes of Mickey Mouse, Snow White, Dumbo, and Cinderella, as well as other artistic ventures that were not as successful financially, such as Fantasia, or the package films and shorts that were made with the US government during World War II, Walt had also spent several years working on the True Life Adventure series, a series of nature documentaries that found him success both financially and critically, including winning many Academy Awards. He had also started to contemplate this new invention called television and what he could do on the smaller screen. But one idea that kept coming to the front of Walt's mind was one that he came up with on a little park bench in Griffith Park facing a carousel. An idea that would become the happiest place on Earth. An idea that is Disneyland. After an ultimately unsuccessful opening day called Black Tuesday, Disneyland eventually became a roaring success, leaving many wondering when a park like this would come to their hometown.
Every night, her passengers are having a ball.
From his days growing up at small towns in Missouri, on through to his days in the Red Cross, Walt Disney's love of the mighty Mississippi and the boats on it shone through, and this could be seen in his creations in Disneyland. On the far side of the park sat a muddy river, on it a boat named the Mark Twain, in the middle an island claimed under the name of Tom Sawyer. All of it an homage to the mighty, muddy Mississippi. As Disneyland's success began to grow, Walt's ideas expanded, and this could first be seen at the New York World's Fair, where he premiered It's a Small World, Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln, and The Carousel of Progress. This was just Walt's first attempt to make a foray into localized Disney theme parks. Proposals rolled in from over 500 locations wanting their very own Disneyland, including places such as Brazil and Egypt, and many locations across the US. One such proposal came from NBC President General Sarnoff, who proposed a northeastern location somewhere around New Jersey or New York. Walt at the time had a working relationship with ABC, who had a third share in Disneyland. However, after ABC canceled the Mickey Mouse Club, that relationship began to sour, and Walt considered the proposal. He sent crews up to investigate the area, who found that the land was not as good as they had been promised, and that the weather would not permit the park to open year-round. Walt thought, however, that if he could enclose the location in a dome and control the weather, this could change that possibility. Ultimately, this park fell through as negotiations deteriorated. Another idea of Walt's was to open multiple Circle Vision theaters across the country. These theaters would show documentary features about the local area in a 360-degree format, much like Walt's already completed America the Beautiful. One proposed location was at the Canadian side of Niagara Falls in a tower which would also house a replica of the Fly to the Moon attraction from Disneyland.
It be too late to alter course, mateys. And there be plundering pirates lurking in every cove, waiting to board. Sit closer together and keep your ruddy hands inboard. That be the best way to repel boarders. And mark well me words, mateys.
Dead men tell now tale.
Civic Center Redevelopment Corporation, or CCRC, was working round the clock to find ways to bolster the draw of two new tourist attractions on the riverfront. The idea was a large outdoor mall entertainment complex, referred to as Riverfront Square. City Mayor Raymond Tucker came up with an idea to ask former Missouri native Walt Disney to create a film for the city's upcoming bicentennial. The proposal was sent to Disney, and on March 28, 1963, delegates from St. Louis met with Walt Disney. Walt was on board to place one of his Circle Vision theaters in this location, as well as an early version of the People Mover. He also proposed the CCRC use his idea from the Jersey Project to enclose the location to enable guests to visit year-round. On May 20th, Walt came to St. Louis to meet with the CCRC and Mayor Tucker. They toured the location where Riverfront Square would be, as well as the new stadium and the construction on the memorial ground. Walt was impressed, saying, quote, "Lots of cities talk, but fail to act." He also visited the Municipal Opera Theater St. Louis, where he was impressed by the large turntable in the center of the stage used to turn new sets out to the audience, an idea that perhaps shaped the Carousel of Progress, which was currently in development for the New York World's Fair. Sometime after this, Walt worked with Wed to develop Riverfront Square as his very own theme park, with a theme based on historic St. Louis. Early ideas for attractions included an actual steamboat to sit on the Mississippi just outside the pavilion, a re-theming of Jungle Cruise based on the Lewis and Clark expedition, and an Audubon room featuring animatronic birds similar to those recently opened in the Enchanted Tiki Room. Riverfront Square was now being referred to as the Midwestern Disneyland. With the new animatronic-based attractions set for the World's Fair pushing Walt and his team at WED to new heights, Walt wanted to push the St. Louis park even further. Riverfront Square was now set to be split into two halves, one focused on Old St. Louis, and the other half focused on Old New Orleans. This section would feature a boat ride through a Louisiana swamp before the boat careened down a waterfall into a show floor in a second basement. It would then travel through caverns before climbing back up to unload. A separate attraction would allow guests to enter a pirate ship and encounter pirates. A third attraction would be a haunted house with stretching rooms, a concept that Walt had been working on for over 10 years. Of what the park would be was looming, and ideas flew fast and loose. On March 16th, Walt gave the presentation followed by a Q&A with the press. The presentation described the park with an entrance with New Orleans on the left and St. Louis on the right. Lighting in the building surrounding the park would give the illusion of dusk. In the St. Louis area would be a small plaza with gifts and food, at the back of which was a theater with revolving stages and audio animatronics telling local history, and a Circorama theater, which was like the Circle Vision theaters except in only 200 degrees of vision instead of 360. An elevator would then take guests down to the floor below. This would feature the Lewis and Clark attraction, in which the boats had been replaced with traveling chair-type cars. This floor would also feature an audio animatronic river pirate show and a still unthemed dark ride. The bottom floor would feature a Circle Vision film called St. Louis Today. On the New Orleans side, there was a recreation of the French Quarter, and the Bayou boat ride had been combined with the pirate attraction into a fiery confrontation with the Pirates of the Caribbean. There would also be a New Orleans themed clone of the Golden Horseshoe, and in one corner, an old haunted mansion. The presentation was a rousing success with all that were in the room, and everyone was looking forward to a new park coming to St. Louis. But it never did. An obstacle stood in Walt's way.